It's my pleasure to introduce Professor Jim Sethna. He's a professor of physics at Cornell. He received his PhD from Princeton, and he did his postdocs both at Cornell and UCSB. He's received awards and recognition, including a Sloan Research Fellowship and a Presidential Young Investigator Award, and has been elected Fellow of the American Physical Society. He has a wonderful graduate textbook on statistical physics that has already become a staple in curricula, not least for its breadth and vision. And of course, this speaks to the most important form in which Jim's work has been recognized, which is its enormous interdisciplinary impact. The fundamental problems Jim has worked on and his insights have led to major innovations in the study of physical, biological, and social systems, and even perhaps philosophically about the nature of science itself, which he will talk about today. So I'm very excited to have Jim speak to us today, not only because his work would be of interest to us, but also because he aligns with what I think SFI scientists aspire to, which is a sort of Jedi level mastery of the subject, which in this case impressively encompasses many sub-disciplines of physics. Also an interest in fundamental questions that knit disciplines together, and something that we value highly here, which is a renegade streak and a willingness to challenge established wisdom and to do it in a convincing way. So without further ado, Professor Jim Sethna, and Jim, maybe you can say the thing about people being allowed to interrupt you at any time.
Again, oh yeah, please interrupt as much as you can. So I'm very happy to be here, and I've never had such an impressive introduction. And I guess part of my renegade is the term sloppy models, which has caused both interest and concern. People don't like to have their models called sloppy, but I'm going to tell you about sloppy models. These are multi-parameter models fit to data, and what I'm telling you has been the result of collaborations with an enormous number of really talented graduate students and colleagues over the past 15 years or so. I'll start out by telling you about parameters. Multi-parameter models fit to data are the subject of the talk, and systems biology is where it began, but there are an enormous number of other places where we found applications, including in physics. And then I'm going to explain the behavior we see, this bizarre, ill-conditioned nature of things, in terms of differential geometry. So I'll have a brief introduction to what we'll call the model manifold, and then some theorems that you can prove using the behavior of multi-parameter models fit to data. And then at the end of the talk, I'm going to return to things that might be of direct interest to people who do statistical mechanics types of modeling. And also physicist type of modeling, where you take a complicated system and you try to make it comprehensible and simple, treating the essence of the problem, and trying to connect that to the model reduction point of view, where you start with the complicated model and then you systematically extract the emergent behavior. And from the physics point of view, and I'm led here by Phil Anderson's more is different kind of ideas. I'm interested in the repeating pattern of having theories on one scale spawning theories at lower energy scales, or at larger length scales, or at collective scales. And here, high energy theory emphasizes the fundamentals moving up this tree and to higher and higher energy. And they find that their theories get simpler and more beautiful as you go up. And Schrodinger's equation is sort of the messy engineering world for them. And for the rest of us, we go up this ladder, and you can say social systems and biophysics and things are up on these trees. There, the emergent behavior, the simple patterns are emerging at lower and lower scales, and the messiest is Schrodinger. And I haven't a clue why Schrodinger's equation is so nasty. In physics, we have controlled approximations and small parameters, but in all the other sciences, by and large, there's no systematic way of seeing the simplicity that emerges out of the collective behavior, or it's much more challenging because you can't say I'm going to go to long length scales and coarse grain and things like that. So the two pieces, there's reductionism, which is like the renormalization group and like continuum limits, versus synthesis, where you guess the behavior by looking at you guess the theory underlying the behavior by finding a simple conceptual model to explain it. And then there's the other side. If you can make simple conceptual models, does that mean that show the same behavior as a system, to what extent do you really understand it without having a microscopic picture? And to what extent could many competing models explain the same data because the behavior of the system is simple? So let me start with the place that we stumbled into this, which is systems biology. My group dragged me into a subject I knew nothing about, a common picture that happens in my group. And they insisted we start talking with a cancer biologist. And Rick Serione gradually took us from sort of crazy chit chat to something very tangible. This was a model of cell signaling, which he drew this picture, and we said, what does this picture mean? And then he drew these equations. He had a chemical engineering background. He wasn't afraid of equations. But he did say he couldn't get anyone to actually program those equations and see how it behaved because his students and postdocs didn't like equations. So he said, could we help? And I said, well, we can type in equations. But it rapidly became clear the problem wasn't the equations. The problem was that there are 48 free parameters. So here's one of the equations, and it has six parameters, various rate constants and things combine into these already coarse-grained equations, which are called Michaelis-Menten equations. And this is a nonlinear ordinary differential equation with 48 free parameters. And we were asking him, so what are all the parameters that he didn't know? He didn't know them within a factor of 1,000. And so we said, couldn't you measure them? And he said, I wouldn't be able to pay people to measure them. It would be too boring and they would never get another job. And to be frank, he was right. And I'm going to tell you that the parameters are unimportant for understanding the behavior. And in fact, in some deep sense, they are useless because this model is not correct. Never mind. Okay, so the question here is, if you did fit all the data, would you believe it with 48 parameters? And I will give you a hint, 63 data points. How could you imagine that it would make a predictive model? And now he encouraged us to do it, and he was correct, but I was correct. I was correct that you could not possibly figure out what the parameters were. And I was spectacularly correct. Here are the error bars, fractional error bars on the different parameters. You notice the best known parameters are known to a factor of 50. That's a 5,000% error. And that's the parameter that works best. The others are much worse. And really, it's because he said he knew it within a factor of 1,000, we gave it a factor of 1,000 in both directions. Here is our first triumph, that he wrote down the model and he said, I think if I add this drug to disable this particular piece, it's this piece here, this drug. I think it will make this blue curve go, sorry, this red curve go up and look like this blue curve. And our model said no, that the red curve would stay down. I can detail you how that was important for the behavior of the system, but our model disagreed and said that stuff on the left wasn't very useful, wasn't important. And what's amazing is not that we got the right answer, which we did, that the computer was right, and Rick Serion unbelievably wasn't correct on this issue, but that the model could make any predictions at all. That this error bar is one sigma, but it's less than a 20% error bar in an ensemble where all the parameters were varying by at least a factor of 50. How can you do that? And so this is going to be a theme, that you can make useful models without knowing anything about the parameters. And so here's an example. This isn't our model, it's fits of decaying exponentials, but you can see that even though each of the individual parameters, there's a landscape and there's a best fit someplace, but some directions of deviation, some combinations of parameters make a lot of difference. We call those stiff. And others make much less difference. We call those sloppy directions. And here you can see the sloppy direction is quite a bit less sloppy than the stiff direction. What you haven't noticed, unless you've seen my talk before, is the axes here are a factor of 1,000 different. So the horizontal direction should be stretched out by, I don't know, a tenth of a kilometer on your screen, or if this is a regular talk, it would be about a kilometer. And that's the typical range of sloppiness that I will talk about. The behavior is ill-conditioned. You cannot extract the parameters from the data, but any of the reasonable fits work well because only a few stiff combinations of parameters matter. Another thing I will do repeatedly in this talk is talk about the eigenvalues of this cost function. So the cost is the sum of the squares of the data minus the predictions. And that sum of the squares has a minimum, and I take a quadratic expansion about the minimum. And that will also be the metric in our differential geometry later. Here are some eigenvalues. Here are the eigenvalues for the cell signaling problem. I told you that there's a factor of 1,000 between the stiffest and sloppiest direction. And sure enough, this 10 to the 6th, the square root of it is 1,000. That's the aspect ratio of the ellipses. Actually, these numbers go down to 10 to the minus 11. We just cut it off at 10 to the minus 6 because it just seemed to be beating a dead horse to say the large range. This is quantum wave functions. This is the best quantum chemistry calculations rely on variational wave functions that are sloppy. This is the cosmic microwave background radiation. It looks less impressive only because there are only seven parameters in it. Eight parameters? How come I only have six lines? I don't know. Anyway, these are applications I'll talk about later. Diffusion equations, cosmic microwave background radiation, the Ising model. They're all sloppy. I have to fiddle with these two to give them more parameters because you usually think of diffusion in terms of the stiffest direction, which is the diffusion constant. And then here's a model of particle accelerators that we actually use the sloppiness in order to design algorithms to tune the accelerator in real time. We've done this in a lot of other problems. My former students and other people, this is a neural network. This is a circadian clock. This is power systems in the US electrical system. The Huxley model of neuroscience, they're all sloppy. Notice sloppy means roughly equally spaced eigenvalues as a function of log. This, we thought, had to be important. If you have a separation of time scales, you can get some directions that are very unimportant. But there's no particular reason why they should be equally spaced all the way up and down. The equally spacing made me feel like there was some deep underlying picture, and I will explain to you what I think it is. Well, we've proven it is, if you like. So until now, I've been talking about least squares models, but a lot of these models, like the Ising model, aren't things that make data point predictions. They're things that predict probability distributions. Probability distributions of spin configurations, probability distributions of patterns in the microwave background radiation. And for those, I can't just use least squares. I have to define a distance between probability distributions and the natural distance of the Fisher information metric. And I don't want to beat it to death, but for least squares models, it reduces to the distance between the experiment and the data. And it has deep ties to estimating parameters. So the fact that you can't estimate the parameters has to do with the inverse of this metric. So the small eigenvalues that you saw tell you that you can't estimate parameters well. And then Ben Machta has this very cool argument that the entropy cost for thermodynamic control is the path distance in the using the Fisher information metric, where my translation is, or his translation, is the Carnot cycle actually costs you entropy as you go around it, because somebody has to figure out when to push the piston in and when to open and shut the shutters. Using the Fisher information metric, we studied the Ising model and the diffusion equation. You can make the Ising model multi-parameter by adding longer bonds. And you know it doesn't change the universality class because it's universal. And you know if you coarse grain, you'll get the universal behavior. But here is the Fisher information metric turning that into something beautiful. So you can look at the eigenvalues for the original problem, and they're not very sloppy. But as you coarse grain, only the relevant parameters, H and T, become eigendirections. And all the other irrelevant parameters become eigendirections that get smaller and smaller as you coarse grain. So without knowing about with coarse graining, but without understanding normalization loop flows and things like that, you can pick out the relevant and irrelevant directions just by using this kind of information geometry, this kind of the Fisher information metric, thinking about it in terms of sloppy models. So I'm going to claim that most of physics rests on this, in addition to most of the rest of science. Okay, I'll pause here a moment for questions.
So, Jim, are you effectively saying that as you coarse grain, you're able to average over stuff so that it doesn't matter very much, so that by the time we get off to the right of your diagram, that we're just kind of seeing bulk modes and the coarse graining is suppressing the sort of more microscopic modes that we no longer care about.
And that's well known in physics, but the same thing happens in cell signaling, in signal transductions in cells, and without any obvious microscopic reason. Mm-hmm. And we can show that it will happen typically. We can show that simple behavior should almost always arise from complicated systems, that only a few combinations of parameters will control the emergent behavior. And that's, I think, just amazing.
Mm-hmm. Jim, can I ask a question?
Yep.
So in the chemical signaling, for instance, if some parameter matters very little, it would be tempting to think that that term could just be removed from the equation.
I will address that question. I used to have an answer that was lame, like it's not parameters, it's parameter combinations.
That's what I thought the answer was. But, yeah.
But Mark Tranström has given me a much more nuanced answer, and he can actually remove parameters in a very sneaky way, which I will tell you at the end of this talk.
Can I ask a question from a statistics perspective? In statistics terminology, I think what you call sloppiness would be called like weak identification or something like that. And what
ill-conditioned is more common in our field, but yeah, there are modes that can't be tailed apart, and I've forgotten the name for it. And then what would you call it again?
Identification.
Non-identifiable and weakly identifiable. Exactly, it's right. The same thing.
So I guess the standard recommendation there is to reparameterize the model, and I some people go as far as to say that the model has a problem if it's not well identified. And in some cases, it's as simple as just dividing the parameter by a trillion or something, so that what you call sloppy becomes.
No. So I'm gonna argue, we used to think that we had just gotten the wrong basis, but you can view it using differential geometry and you discover there's something intrinsic about the model behavior. It's not the parameterization. And then that's the next step. You've led into my next question. How do we tell that it's just not that we chose stupid parameters? We're smart. We obviously picked the right units to make the units right. But how do you know that the proper thing to do is not to add and subtract them in this particular way to make it? And you can change coordinates and all these poorly identified directions go away. But
Sorry, Jim, this is Sri Iyer Biswas. I wanted to jump in and ask if this geometry aspect that you're about to come to is related to the mystery of why it's important that the eigenvalues are evenly distributed on the log scale.
We will end up explaining it in a sneaky way. That there will be a theorem that's coming that the eigenvalues will be equally distributed in log, except we'll first have to tell you the eigenvalues are almost always, apart from these coordinate transformations, related to thicknesses of the model manifold. And then we'll show you the thicknesses of the model manifold are equally spaced in log.
Cool, look forward.
So next behavior. So those two last questions are really saying, how do you know this isn't just coordinates? And how do you prove to me that I'll get equally spaced in log? So I had to introduce the model manifold. So here's a simple nonlinear model, two exponentials, two constants, that produce a two-dimensional surface in the space of all possible behaviors. I'm going to define behaviors of this model. The experiments are ruled by how long you wait, the time, and I'm going to have three data points, T1, T2, and T3, and that'll give me a three-dimensional space of possible y's, y1, y2, and y3, and this will trace out a two-dimensional surface in this three-dimensional space. So before I was looking about parameters, theta 1 and theta 2, best fits, the contours of good fits but not perfect fits, and now I'm shifting perspective where thetas are just the parameters, the coordinates on some manifold. That manifold has a metric that's given by your experiment. It depends upon what the things you measure and how accurately you can measure them. Those are real things. So this is a statement about the behavior that's described by this complicated model, or in this case, simple model. The model boundaries are important. I'm going to come to that over and over again. So this is not just a piece of this model. When theta 1 goes from 0 to infinity and theta 2 goes from 0 to infinity, the behavior is confined to this curved triangular region. This boundary is where one of the thetas went to infinity. This boundary is where one of the thetas goes to 0. This point is the point where the model drops immediately to 1 and then goes constant forever after. And this final edge happens to be a symmetry of the model where theta 1 equals theta 2. So the model takes this infinite square and folds it into a triangle. The fact that the model boundaries have only one effective parameter, they're simpler models, is going to come back into the coarse graining that we talked about earlier, that we have a sneaky way of answering Chris's question. I think it was Chris's question that can you throw away parameters? So we're going to throw away parameters by going to the edge of the model manifold. The metric, you remember I promised the metric, the distance in this embedding space is the least squares distance. It's telling you the sum of the squares of the errors in all the parameters, and you can change it to be the sum of the squares divided by their error bars. And that tells you the Fisher information metric that we're going to be using. So on this manifold, the distance is given by the least squares, same least squares distance that you're minimizing to get the best fit. Final thing I have to tell you before I go on is I'm going to be taking cross sections of this model manifold. I'm going to be later on asking what happens if I measure time T2 and I now know what Y2 is. I take this two-dimensional surface and I replace it with a one-dimensional surface at y2 equal to measured value. Everyone see that? So I'm going to do that and I'm going to make hay out of that. I'm going to explain the connection I'm going to explain the hierarchy in widths of the model manifold using that construction.
Jim, just to be sure I'm with you conceptually. So because you're thinking about fitting to the data, right? So there's some things you would normally call noise in here, which is the deviations from the data. And so when you said measure Y2, you mean that somehow you measure that one exactly so that you know exactly what that one is and you don't have any more noise.
I'm conflating fitting real data and pretending my model was perfect with no noise and then doing geometry. So you're right. Okay. I'm not actually measuring Y2 in an experiment. I'm imagining I knew exactly what Y2 is and I'm seeing how the model predictions change.
Okay.
But I will freely shift from one to the other, even though, especially in biology, the error bars are huge compared to anything.
Great, thanks.
Good. And remember now, this is a two-parameter model in a three-dimensional space, and our original model was a 48-dimensional manifold in sitting in a 63-dimensional space. The model manifold, I will argue, is a hyperribbon. You know hypercubes, you know hyperspheres. I made up the term hyperribbon because it's obviously the thing we have. As you can see, it's got a long direction, it's got a medium direction, it's got a thin direction. It just keeps doing that over and over again. It's got thinner and thinner and thinner directions. Here in the X's are the widths of this model manifold. I'm measuring the widths by taking the longest direction, and then I take a point in the middle, I find the stiff and sloppy directions, and I move along one of them and I measure the geodesic distance to the edge, and then I move along another one. Since the eigendirections are an orthogonal local coordinates, I can take geodesics along each one of them and find a width. And you can see they're geometrically spaced. In fact, they match almost precisely the square roots of the eigenvalues of the thing of the direction that I use to measure the width. So if I can explain why the widths have a geometric decay, I should be able to also, I will have implicitly explained why the eigenvalues have a geometric decay. You may argue that the eigenvalues are coordinate dependent, and it's true, but you remember we're changing things by 10 to the sixth, and you'd have to do a pretty drastic coordinate change to screw this up. And in the models we've looked at, mostly people pick pretty good, sensible choices for their parameters. They go to natural units, and this procedure always seems to work pretty well. But in any case, the concern that this was a problem with picking the wrong coordinates goes away when you go into the model behavior and you see this hyperribbon structure. I haven't explained to you that why it's a hyperribbon. All I'm telling you is it's a hyperribbon and the thin directions are the sloppy directions. The directions where the parameters are very poorly defined means you can move a long way without changing the behavior, and the behavior is thin. Everyone good?
Jim, may I ask? Yeah. This factor, this no. square root is very mysterious. The factor of half, where did it come from?
You remember
the squares?
Yeah, I understand. You remember the in this parameter space, the axes of the ellipses, the long, the length of the principal axes, what is the square root of their eigenvalue?
I see.
So if that helps.
I see. I was wondering if it was related to the choice of how distance was defined.
I think it's also got units. So the square root of the eigenvalue has the right, somehow has the right unit. Somebody needs to mute. I don't know who. Oh, good. Okay. So we now have rigorous hyperellipsoid bounds on the model manifold. So like a hyperribbon, a hyperellipsoid is what you think it is. It's got a long axis, a medium axis, a smaller axis, and geometrically smaller and smaller axes. And we can prove this for a model where the model predictions depend smoothly on the experimental conditions. So this is not analyticity in the model parameters, it's analyticity in things like time, where you're measuring things at different times. And if you have a radius of convergence R in that, we can explain that this hyperellipsoid is going to get thinner and thinner by a power of R over the change in the experimental conditions. And I'll give you the argument in just a moment. But this is a rigorous analysis, and it'll come from approximation theory. So I think we now have a really solid handle on least squares problems of why you get a hierarchy of eigenvalues. You get that because you have a hierarchy of widths of the model manifold, and you get that because the model manifold sits in something that looks like a hyperellipsoid. Why is it a hyperribbon? This is an argument of Mark Tranström. The proof is by Catherine Quinn and Heather Wilbur and Alex Townsend, two mathematicians and a physicist, Catherine. The hyperribbon can be argued by as a approximation argument that you know if you have a function that's nice and smooth as a function of time here, that if you take equally spaced points or points at any positions and interpolate, the true answer will be bounded by some small possible errors that vanish at the places where you know the function. You remember that every time I take a measurement of my behavior, it takes a slice of the model manifold. So this width is the range of possible behaviors. It gives you the spatial extent of the width of the model manifold, the range of possible behaviors given the that you've already measured one of these data points. So measuring one data point tells you widths of all the other possible measurements. The fact that that has a nice bound in terms of the mth derivative of your function with respect to time, which is the standard formula. If you think about the mth derivative and you use the ratio test to be a physicist and use the ratio test to turn that into a radius of convergence, this just turns out to be the separation between the time points divided by the radius of convergence to the nth power. So each slice, every time I take one more cut of the model manifold, here I only can cut twice and then I've got a point, but each time I take a cut of the 48 dimensional model manifold, it reduces the model manifold thickness by another factor of delta T over R. And that gives us a hierarchy of width. Another way of thinking about it is, as soon as you have enough data to have one data point for each radius of convergence, if you have data separated by more than a radius of convergence, you're not sloppy. But as soon as you start adding data points within a radius of convergence, then you'll see a sloppiness coming up.
Jim, can you say what delta T and R are?
So delta T in this particular case is the distance between the measured data points, or maybe the range of data points. This is the true formula, okay? This is my heuristic that this to the m over m factorial is r to the m, and here m factors of delta of something like t minus data points. So if I want the value here, t minus t1 is this, t minus t2 is this, t minus t4 is that. And then I'm just being a physicist and saying all of these are delta t, where delta t is the the range over which I've had data points.
And so I understand your notation, Y superscript M in that formula of psi. What are psi?
This is the bound on the mth derivative of the theory.
Right. And so R is some kind of measure of how curvy the thing that you're trying to fit is?
So R, yeah, that's a better answer. I call it the radius of convergence because I'm using the ratio test to turn this formula into something involving R. But but you don't want to think of it as a radius of convergence because some of our models have infinite radius of convergence, but they have a natural scale on which they change. And that's what you should use here.
But R is related to curvature in the end of the target.
The word reality. Curvature makes you think of second derivative, and obviously I'm using it to bound the mth derivative, but it's like a curvature in a more general sense.
All right.
It's a natural length scale over which any derivative changes.
Mm-hmm. Thanks.
Good questions.
Hey, Jim, I'm a little troubled by the fact that I see the argument, but these are kind of finer and finer measurements of the same parameter as opposed to what I imagine is like measuring things.
You can do this in multiple dimensions. So there's a part of the paper in the theorem that does it for higher dimensions. And it's really a statement that's related to the Van de Mon matrix and things like that. It's it's cool. There's real math here that underlies this weird behavior.
Oh, I know, and it's great. I mean I see.
No,
I
think but I guess what I'm suggesting is that you constrain the behavior of this model in a similar sense to interpolation theory. And the fact that interpolation theory works ends up translating into the model has behavior that only depends upon a few combinations of parameters. And that connection is at root the explanation for why multi-parameter models end up not giving you multi-parameter behavior.
So I guess what I'm imagining is that this fits if there's a finite dimensional space of, as you said before, experimental conditions that I can vary.
Yeah.
The temperature at which I measure, the time at which I measure, and so on. If I really want to learn something about a parameter that is I have to design new kind of experiment, like an intervention or something.
Yeah, you're absolutely right that the sloppiness I'm describing is when I take a model and I look at its collective behavior. And what collective behavior is a matter of opinion. But what it isn't is measuring each of the parameters separately with a separate experiment. I can certainly design models and a set of experiments that you're interested in that are not sloppy, but but it's manifest that they're decoupled into smaller subsystems, each of which you're measuring one parameter, things like that. It, when you end up looking at the collective behavior, so the Ising model is not sloppy until you coarse grain. If you really are interested in measure all those microscopic details, you don't get the simple behavior. But most of the time, we're interested in the collective behavior, and it's the collective behavior that ends up being sloppy. You're absolutely right.
So can I kind of follow up on that question?
Yep.
So if I understand you correctly, the key to this proof is that there's an analyticity relating the measurements that you're going to make with the parameters of the model. And so I work a lot.
The Yeah, the measurements right. I'm going to make, it's the analyticity in the experimental conditions.
Right. So, yeah. Right. Exactly. Mm-hmm. So my predictions are an analytic function of the parameters.
No, of the control parameters, not of the model parameters.
Okay. All right. Fair enough.
Yeah. Good. Yeah.
But so I'm often working in inference in the context of nonlinear dynamics, and it's quite easy. For example, in time, it's very common to have non-analytic relationships. You know, that radius of convergence in the time direction is quite short relative to what our observations are. So what happens then is my question. What happens beyond that?
We keep asking the question, what about chaos? Where obviously there's sensitive dependence on initial conditions.
Right.
And I think the answer would be, although I haven't done this carefully, that if I take a chaotic system and I really want to know what the answer is after a long time, it's probably not sloppy. All the parameters matter. That's not true. Lyapunov exponents are a representation of sloppiness. Only a few Lyapunov exponents grow. A lot of them are small. The fact that you have a spectrum of Lyapunov exponents can actually be translated into sloppy models. But the other thing I should say is that the behavior you care about is typically not the detailed dynamics, it's the attractor. And I bet the attractor and the properties of the attractor that you actually want to know about will show sloppy behavior in a multi-parameter dynamical system. So two aspects, the Lyapunov exponents, I don't know if it's actually been explained why Lyapunov exponents tend to be roughly equally spaced, which turns out to be the roughly equally spaced and log in the behavior. But there's a nice analogy there. And there's a nice analogy between collective behavior and attractors, which is the way we think about chaotic systems. So let me move on. So these are the hyperellipsoid bounds for three models, one from physics, chemistry, and biology. And these are very simple models that we can exhaustively study. And here are the bounds that the rigorous things give, and here are the actual eigenvalues, suggesting that our statement that we have a rigorous bound is actually connected with the roughly equally spaced behavior you see in physical models. Okay, I'm now going into StatMac, and I'll start with looking at the Ising model in the cosmic microwave background radiation, and then I'll give you this model reduction. And maybe I'll go a little faster because at the Santa Fe Institute, a lot of people are less interested in the Ising model than they are about more general collective behavior. So in the Ising model, you discover that it's hard to write the model manifold. That the natural distance being the Fisher information metric, Euclidean and isometric embeddings of the behavior space tend to be horrible. And there's a sneaky method using replica theory that Catherine Quinn came up with to draw visualizations. And here is the visualization we have of a large family of universes with parameters in the cosmic microwave in models for the cosmic microwave background radiation. I'm going quickly here. Here is the latest embedding of the two-dimensional Ising model, which I promised Dan Stein. We call this the icicle embedding. It's because it's the symmetrized Kolbach-Leibler divergence that we use to find distances between points. And this is a this is an isometric embedding of the properties of the Ising model using the Fisher information metric. Here's the critical point, here's the jump in magnetization. It's embedded, however, not in Euclidean space. Catherine's result was that any embedding in Euclidean space would be a mess and you couldn't get anything out of it. This is a low dimensional embedding. It's so sloppy, it truncates after four directions. But the only problem is it's sitting in Minkowski space and we're still absorbing that. But now I want to get to the model reduction. I promised that people would always ask me, if you have 48 parameters and only five of them matter, why don't you throw away a lot of them? And that's actually a pretty typical thing. People say, I think I can guess all but five of the parameters and I'll guess them and then I'll fit the last five. And it works. And it works because there are only five directions in parameter space that matter. And if you have five parameters that are not orthogonal to those directions, you can monkey with them and get pretty good fits. But that doesn't give you predictive power because you're not getting the right parameters and you don't know what changes when you change the other parameters. But what Tranström did was he, and then the sloppiest eigendirection is this random combination of parameters, and you don't know which one to throw away, even though you don't care about the sloppiest eigendirection. What Mark Tranström found was as he moved to the edge of the model manifold to do things like measure the width, he would take a geodesic along one of the sloppy directions, he would hit the edge. And as he hit the edge, this complicated eigendirection would simplify. And in retrospect, it's simplifying because this is a simpler model. This is a model in which maybe the forward and backward reactions are getting faster and faster until they reach equilibrium. That's a simpler model. And this is the forward and backward reaction rates that are going up together. So their logs are becoming bigger and bigger and staying the same.
Jim, can I ask a question to make sure I'm with you? Are what you're thinking about doing here, are you taking some parameter in the model and you're turning that parameter down to zero to hit the boundary? No.
Nope.
So what are you, you're following a geodesic somehow, but I guess what I want to understand when the eigen spectrum is changing here, what is it that you're doing that's changing the eigenspectrum?
So
what are you actually changing?
So at the original set of parameters, different parameters were stiff and sloppy.
Uh-huh.
But I keep changing and moving in this direction. And as I remember, this is a very thin direction. So I can move all the way to infinity along this eigendirection of the Fisher information metric, I can move all the way to infinity and I get a very small change in behavior. So this point fits the data almost as well as this one, but some of the parameters have gone to infinity or zero.
Okay. And because what you're doing is you figure out what the geodesic is, and now you make a change in all the parameters potentially.
Correct.
At once, and you incrementally change them and you follow along the geodesic till you hit the boundary. And right. Now you have some new set of parameters.
And the new set of parameters are not the original parameters. They've all moved a little bit, but a few of them have moved to crazy places that make for a simpler model.
Right. Got you. And go ahead.
Go ahead.
No, I mean, one of the virtues of neural nets that people have said, neural nets with sigmoids, is that neural nets, when you train them, they can switch effectively degrees of freedom on and off to basically as the training happens. So maybe this is related to what you're talking about here.
I'd have to think about that.
Okay.
So this would remove one effective parameter, and they did 36 times, and he got a much less sloppy system. And I will show you here. This is the original model. You remember all these complicated interactions and the nonlinear equations. And here's the new one. Three things to think of. One thing is here, my expert would tell us this is the main pathway. This is a negative feedback loop. This is the negative feedback loop that turns down the behavior after a little while. And this is a positive feedback loop that keeps this signaling up. We discovered this loop didn't matter and it went away. Here's the negative feedback loop. Here's the positive feedback loop. All of his instincts came out of an automatic coarse graining. Here are the new equations. It's not as sloppy. Here are the new equations. The reduced model fits all the experimental data almost as well as the original model. And each of these effective parameters in this reduced set of equations have explicit formulas in terms of the original parameters. And this was done without any human insight.
Cool.
This is just amazing. And he's done this for power systems, and he's discovered new aspects, which in retrospect you could have come up with if you were wise and experienced. But we're replacing wisdom and experience with algorithms here. So thank you very much.
Yep. Hooray. Maybe, okay. I'm sorry, I'm asking a lot of questions, but
no.
I guess you have done this using interpolation. I guess that surprised me. I would have thought you would have studied approximation, which is obviously a related problem, but that's usually what one does. You began it with least squares, right? So with least squares, you're taking some data and you put the manifold that's close to everything, as opposed to finding a manifold that goes through the data points. And they're obviously related, but maybe you could say about how you got away to the same conclusions apply to approximation. Have you been able to do that problem too?
Okay, so first statement was, if my common sense as to what was important would have worked, it would have taken less than 10 years to figure it out. Or 15 years or something like that. We only recently figured this out. And it was, you know, lots of graduate students. First of all, convincing ourselves that sloppiness was not just one model that happened all the time. And then the differential geometry picture, and then the interpolation theory just fell out. The problem of interpolation theory and the problem of best approximations to complex functions, if that's what you're aiming at, those are very closely related subjects. And I'm not sure that I couldn't do something similar with, in fact, Chebyshev polynomials are, I guess Chebyshev polynomials are an interpolation method that they take explicit, but you can get the Chebyshev coefficients by integrating the original function. I'm not sure whether what I'm saying is interpolation theory or approximation theory. I'm not sure I can distinguish them.
Well, but I mean, the way you did it was clearly interpolation theory, because interpolation
there's the theorem,
yeah,
and there's the argument. Our argument was definitely using that formula, but the theorem, there are two variants of it: one using polynomials, and one using Chebyshev approximations. And the Chebyshev one gives stronger results in many cases. So I'm just saying, when I think about what you said, the taking sine of X and taking data points along it and getting a fit that goes through the data points is closely related to the problem of taking sine of X and finding some kind of polynomial approximation that best approximates it. And I'm not absolutely certain whether I can say that interpolation theory was the right way to think about it and not the other one.
Well, you got a result, so that makes it a nice way to think about it. But I think it's worth trying to pin those things down. And let me just, another problem you might be able to solve here, you know, those of us who have done a lot of approximation, there are certain ways to represent functions that are known to be really bad, like polynomials. Polynomials, just a standard polynomial, is a terrible way to represent functions. And because, why? Because these trade-offs are very dramatic. And so you get very squirrely fits to the parameters as the order of the polynomial gets too high, in particular. And once you get above quadratic,
you have hit, that is another representation of sloppiness. It turns out that the basis of our theorem is that if instead of talking about if you think of a polynomial as a monomial fit, then the seventh derivative has intrinsically to do with the coefficient of x to the seventh in your Taylor series. And the bound on those coefficients turns out to be a hypersphere in monomial space. And then the Vandermonde determinant is telling you how that hypersphere in monomial space corresponds in data space. So you're absolutely right that polynomial interpolation being bad is why sloppiness happens even in models that are not polynomial.
Mm-hmm.
Very nice. Very good insight.
Can I ask a question really quick?
Mm-hmm.
I'm kind of wondering if one can rephrase kind of your central theorem and central way of thinking about things in a information theoretic way, which is something like that the channel from experiments to parameters has a limited capacity. And in particular, that it doesn't grow extensively with the number of data points. So at some point, you're starting to get more data points. You're going to get less and less bits of information about parameter. And I'm wondering if that's kind of a more general way to think about what's going on. And also if you think from that point of view, one could similarly think about what this meaning of the logarithmic spacing would mean.
I have no deep insights into that, but it sounds incredibly cool. It's a very nice idea. You learn less and less about the world by taking more and more data and thinking about that.
Because that's kind of what the bounded curviness is, right? It's like once you start sampling at a smaller resolution, I mean, this is related to, you know, Shannon's, well, Nyquist frequency, stuff like that. Like you only need a certain amount of, you know, to specify a curvy, especially curvy curve.
Yeah, sounds wonderful. I don't have any deep thoughts to exchange on the subject, but it's a cool idea.
I wonder if I could ask you to reflect on something. Or it looks like, Michael, you've raised your hand first. Maybe you should go ahead.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm paying no attention to raised hands. Yes.
Oh, sure. I wanted to ask maybe a simple question. I can't get the intuition in there. Like, I don't understand. Where did all the degrees of freedom go? So are you claiming that in general, if you have a system and in general, a random system with 100 degrees of freedom, most of the degrees of freedom will not be important? Or is it some kind of special systems in this 100 dimensional space? There are some special systems in which most of the degrees of freedom don't matter. Because my intuition is that in most systems, most of the degrees of freedom do matter.
The, each degree of freedom is matters a lot. In our model with 48 parameters, if you change any of them by a factor of two and not fiddle with the others, it'll screw up the biology.
But is this space still 48 dimensions?
I can go back. My picture. So any of these parameters will take you away from this nice valley. Any one parameter will screw things up. What's true though, is if you move one parameter, you can move two or three other parameters and compensate.
But that kind of says that the space isn't 48 dimensional, that it's on the surface, right?
The space of important changes in behavior is much smaller than the total number of parameters.
And you think this is a general property of random 48 parameter systems?
I have not looked seriously at random systems. I can say this is true of all the actual science models we've looked at. And it's a good question, but I think it depends a little bit on what you mean by random. If a random system is generically lots of things interacting in complicated ways, I think it will happen. If your definition of your random ensemble has a large space in which each molecule is infinitely far apart, you know, it's like a difference between a dense liquid and a gas in infinite space. A gas in infinite space, every molecule will be a separate thing in itself, and its behavior will be independent of everybody else. But it would be neat to look at random ensembles and try and figure out.
So isn't part of the way to sort of reconcile Michael's intuition with what you're saying, that the sloppiness emerges not just from the parameters of the system, not just from the system itself, but from the system. It's induced by the system in conjunction with the observations, right? In conjunction with data, right? And so, you know, so I want to invite you to reflect on this, right? So you showed us, you know, numerous examples. The biochemical metabolic network or whatever it was is a good example. So you have all of this complexity, and in the dynamic mode that you're actually observing, that's generating the data, it turns out most of those degrees of freedom don't really matter, right? There's only a few parameter combinations that are relevant, and some of those pathways are much more important than others. And yet this biochemical network evolved, right? Those extraneous pathways are not a sort of an epiphenomenon, right? due to just unavoidable consequences of associated with the main pathways. They're actually there, and there are genes maintaining those things that are selected for. So how do you, I think I can almost see how you would reconcile this, but can you go ahead and think about that for me?
Okay, you mentioned several interesting things. One thing is that I believe you can argue that a lot of the neutral spaces in evolution, some of them are neutral spaces in these parameters, that each mutation will change one of these reaction numbers, and then you need some other mutation. If you want to change the behavior, then it's useful that a mutation will change things. If you want to be able to mutate one of these reaction rates and still survive, you may be able to have two reactions two or three mutations that cancel one another's effects. But there's a very large neutral space in behavior in what we call the chemotype.
Sure.
That's sort of
part of it, right? That you had a couple of different ways, and that's sort of definitely a reflection that is worthwhile. That this the sloppiness that you describe is sort of one mechanism, or maybe a major mechanism that underlies those kinds of neutral neutral moves across the fitness landscape.
Well, what was the other question you asked?
Well, so yeah. I guess I'm thinking about the robustness of biological systems and how you square that with the functional simplicity. And I think the answer is that, you know, if you look at different experimental setups, if you push the system in different ways, these different pathways will become, right? So you've got multiple sloppy systems.
Can take all of the experiments that have been done on the system, and typically they measure 4 or 5 data points, and you can pick continuous number of data points on each of those experiments for every component of this model, and it's just as sloppy. It's not the statement that you have in that there are aspects of the behavior of this model that you don't care about. It's really a statement that the collective behavior for the kinds of experiments you're interested in, the collective behavior is entirely sloppy. Now, if you made a system and you put MSOS and RAS together and you phosphorylated MSOS and looked at the behavior of RAS, it would give you measurements of the individual parameters. And that is true, that if you really pick different things to look at, you can make it not sloppy. But it's not the statement that, because you only care about the actual thing that happens in the nucleus, there are lots of details of what's going on in here that are irrelevant. Everything that goes on here depends only on 4 or 5 parameters.